visited. Brando asked me to give an overview of what is the current situation with the LHC, what it is that we've learned, we are learning, what are the prospects, but then also to look forward to what are the new projects that we are considering at CERN. So I will try to put everything together in a coherent way. I assume everybody knows what the LHC is, so I will not spend time on this. Just a few slides to show and to convince you that indeed things are going very well. The integrated luminosity, which is a measurement of the statistics that's been collected by the experiments, is shown here for last year. What was expected was 25 in units of inverse femtobarns, 40 is what has been achieved. The target luminosity of the LHC, namely the design luminosity, was 1 in 10 to the 34, and as you see, it's been exceeded from June, and for the course of the run went up by 30-40%, and this year, in 2017, they expect to reach close to 2 in 10 to the 34, which is in fact considered as the ultimate luminosity of the LHC. And this is progress that was not expected to take place so early. So the LHC is working extremely well and even better than expected. The LHC doesn't only collide protons, it also stores and collides lead. In 2016, in particular, there was a run with a proton against lead. It may seem trivial, it may even seem simpler than lead-lead. It's actually extremely complicated because the proton is one proton with one charge. Lead, of course, is proton and neutrons, and therefore it has a completely different rigidity. It has a different reaction to the acceleration. So it's extremely non-trivial, and it was not even foreseen at the beginning that anything like this would be possible. In November, the proton lead run achieved a maximum luminosity which is 10 times the design, and that gives you an indication of how challenging this is. I mean, the design, which was intended to be optimistic, had in fact been completely underestimated the potential of this incredible machine. And there were runs in this 1 month at 5 TV, at 8 TV, both in proton lead and lead proton configurations. Of course, we do the two different directions because some of the detectors are asymmetric, and therefore you want to observe both downstream the lead and downstream the proton. And things that emerged from this run are, for example, the first time that top quark pairs are produced outside of a hadron, you know, PP or PP bar environment. And there are the first candidate events of top in proton lead, which by itself, the idea of producing top quarks and detecting top quarks in something like, you know, shooting lead is almost like seeing top coming up of a car crash. So it's really mind-boggling. Of course, it has scientific relevance as well, because that means probing cold nuclear matter effects on the partonic densities of a nucleon at a very, very large Q-square, for the gluon in particular, because glue is what dominates top quark production, and at moderately large X. So it's dynamical and kinematical configurations which have never been probed before. Now, the key pillars of the LHC program, of course, the key pillar was the discovery of the Higgs boson. That's been achieved, as is well known. The exploration and the understanding of electroweak symmetry breaking mechanism. That is the consequence of the discovery. So how far have we gone in testing these? Starting from the parameters of the potential of the Higgs itself, well, so far we've been able to measure two of these parameters. We've been able to look at the... Is there a pointer or a stick? A stick, yeah. Is it? Oh yeah, fantastic. So we're really looking now locally at the minimum of a potential. At the minimum, you can just parameterize this with two parameters, which is the location of a minimum, V. This number has been known for many, many years. and it's been known since SLEP with a precision at the level of per mil. And that knowledge comes out of the measurement of the W and the Z boson mass and the weak mixing angle, which give also the strength of the weak interactions. The missing ingredient was the mass of the Higgs in defining the shape in the quadratic approximation of the potential, and that now is known also with per mil level precision at the level of 2 per mil from the very precise measurements of the Z mass that come from the Higgs mass that come, for example, by looking at these four lepton final states. But beyond that, we don't know anything. So we don't know, we know that at least there have to be coefficients up to the fourth order, the self-coupling and the coupling of the four Higgs, because we expect in the standard model this to be lambda phi to the fourth, but we have still no direct measurement of those, so there is a lot of room for this. Couplings to the other particles of the standard model, this parameter mu is what defines the ratio between the production cross-section and the decay branching ratios for given production and decay channels of the Higgs, normalized to what we expect in the standard model. So this is a measurement of the standard model likeness of the Higgs, and a combination of several measurements in different channels, different decay modes, give us one to within 10%. So that's the level at which we are testing the couplings. This is a more complete breakdown of that information. From the latest data up to the part of 2016 that's been measured, there are examples where this mu is large. This is in the case of a TT Higgs, that's the measurement of a top Yukawa coupling. It's one of the key parameters that still remains to be directly probed, because the statistics has not been enough, and as you see, it's kind of high by one sigma, 1.7 plus or minus 0.8. Some other measurements, the direct coupling of the Higgs to BB bar via associated production of the Higgs is low. Instead of being 1, it's 0.2 plus or minus 5. TT Higgs with Higgs goes to BB bar from CMS, contrary to Atlas, where Atlas is high, CMS is even negative. In other words, the background is bigger than what you would expect. So it's absolutely obvious that things here are not conclusive in any way. And other couplings which are measured a bit more precisely, for which the statistics is enough, like the coupling to the Z and to the gamma-gamma, this is the cross-section which is measured by Atlas, and as you see, is in good agreement with the expectations. These are the 13 TV points, and likewise for CMS. So it's obvious that it's still very, very early. There are several open issues, which is the overall precision. How far can we push the precision of a coupling measurement? What will it take to get to the percent level that would become decisive in understanding whether there are signals of new physics? At the level of 10 or 20%, it's not yet really compelling. We certainly would like to measure the couplings to the second generation, the muon and the charm. In the case of the muon, we know that it takes at least, it's actually much more than 10 times. It's of the order of 1,000. What I meant here is 10 times the statistics available by the end of this current run. So it will be of the order of 1 inverse attobal, something that will take the next 10 or 15 years before we reach a precise determination of Higgs to mu plus mu minus at the 5 sigma level. There are issues, of course, related to the Higgs and masses in general. Where is the mass of the neutrinos coming from? Certainly it's not an obvious the Higgs is not an obvious source of it, but there are measurements that can be done at the LHC to explore this issue. And the question, of course, whether there is more Higgs bosons, as one would expect in models beyond the standard model. The Higgs itself, of course, is a mass, and we expect it to come from the Higgs web. But again, that really has to be proven, and in order for that to be for those measurements to be tested, one needs to couple the Higgs self to observe the Higgs self interaction, the cubic term in the potential. And here again, it will take of the order of this is 3 inverse atoms, so this is 100 times the luminosity available today before we get to a precision of a level of 60%. So to call it precision is perhaps a big word. In other words, there is a lot of work that needs to be done in really clarifying the properties of the Higgs and even more in general the issue of electroweak symmetry breaking. And of course, this is important. I mean, we study the Higgs boson because it's directly connected to many key questions. Of course, what's the real origin of the Higgs potential? Where does this 5^4 come from? Is it induced by randomization group evolution from the gut scales, as we see in some models, like in supersymmetry, for example? Are there other Higgs-like states or electroweak singlets, charge Higgses? Now, one important thing is that, of course, in the course of the evolution of the universe, there was an electroweak phase transition during the Big Bang, in which electroweak symmetry was broken. And the nature of this phase transition is very important, because had it been sufficiently strong, for example, and accompanied by an ACP violation, it could have allowed the conditions for electroweak baryogenesis. And in the standard model, that would not be possible with the parameters we have, with the mass of the Higgs boson at 125 GeV, but the presence, for example, of different couplings, if a potential instead of being lambda phi to the fourth, where lambda phi to the sixth, for example, the whole structure of the potential would change, and one could indeed identify parameters for which a strong first-order phase transition is possible. In general, whether or not electroweak baryogenesis took place at the electroweak phase transition, or for example during leptogenesis, it's obviously important to understand what the precise nature of electroweak phase transition was, because this could have washed out some possible pre-existing baryon asymmetry. Obviously, some would have had to be left, because we observe it today, but the exact quantitative assessment requires that we know exactly what happens as we go through this crucial, critical phase in the history of the universe. And then, of course, there is the overall interplay with dark matter as well, which is particularly interesting, and it's tempting to speculate, and there are many models in which these whole things, electroweak symmetry breaking, baryogenesis, and dark matter are coupled together. On the theory side, needless to say, there is the usual hierarchy problem, namely the question of what protects the smallness of the Higgs mass with respect to the Planck and the gut scales. So, you know, we're very far from having completed, therefore, these important pillars of the program. Now, the other pillar is the search for phenomena beyond the standard model. There is known physics beyond the standard model: dark matter, new sources of CP violation and the origin of baryon symmetry of the universe, neutrino masses. There are theoretically justified BSM issues, understanding the origin of electroweak symmetry breaking, the solutions to the hierarchy problem, and these, of course, direct most of the searches that are done at the LHC. But of course, there are also surprises, things that, you know, we weren't looking for and that maybe show up. And one good example was this diphoton resonance that showed up in December 2015 at 750 GeV. These are the latest data from the run, from the statistics that was accumulated last year, and there is no evidence left of this signal. Nevertheless, I think that this is important. There is a message here, and the message is that little we know about the TV scale. In other words, you know, the fact that one day the experiments come and they tell us there is something going to 2 gammas at 750 GeV, people think a bit about that, and all of a sudden there is a 100 paper that pretty much accept the idea that yes, this signal could be there, even though nobody had thought about it, really tells us that we are completely ignorant about what could be there. You know, in many other cases, like when the neutrinos faster than light came out a few years ago, immediately there were also many papers, and with a couple of exceptions, all of those papers said this is totally impossible, because if that were the case, we would have seen it already. Here, nobody claimed this is impossible. Okay, so we're really open. We must be open, and surprises like this could come out any time. We should really be open. So the probes of BSM physics, of course, are the direct search for new particles. What we saw was just an example. And all of the other searches driven by theoretical prejudice for supersymmetry, compositeness, you name it, they all end up with limits, and you may have seen tables like these a gazillion times. The bottom line is that there is absolutely no signal of physics beyond the standard model so far. But there is also the indirect manifestation of new physics through measurements, well, of the Higgs properties, of course, when they will be more precise, gauge boson couplings, flavor sector, heavy flavor decays. And this is one area in which, in fact, if anything, there are few examples of small anomalies coming from flavor. I will not explain this one, but this is easy to see and is probably well known. It's the ratio branching ratios for B going to K on mu plus mu minus and B to K on E plus E minus. This number should be 1 after accounting for the trivial phase space and electroweak electromagnetic corrections, but it's measured to be 0.75. at the level of 2.5 sigma. It's dominated by statistical uncertainty, and obviously more data will tell us where we go. This number being measured different from 1 would be pretty much, there is no theoretical uncertainty on this, and also experimentally it's a very precise, systematically speaking, it's a very precise measurement, so that would be very, very compelling. It's not like the G minus 2, this would really be almost like a mu to e gamma observation. There are slightly more difficult to interpret phenomenologically, so with bigger systematics, but other anomalies in the decay of a B to tau, semi-leptonic decays, where now the differences between tau decays and muon decays. This is what the standard model would predict, and this is the average of the measurements from various experiments. And this is in the plane of the decay to D versus decay to D star, and we see that there is this discrepancy between the standard model prediction and the average of what is seen. So in LHCb, which is the key experiment to carry out these measurements, is increasing slowly, not as fast as the other experiments because it has a more limited statistics, but it's increasing the level of the amount of data, and you know, sooner or later these things will be clarified. So that was the pillars and the foundations. In order to really make this possible, we have to build on something very robust, which starts from a complete understanding and control of the underlying dynamics, and in particular an accurate knowledge of the proton, the proton structure, the PDF, the parton density functions of quarks and gluons inside the proton. That's what allows us to make precise predictions. Typically, this information was coming from HERA, from fixed target or deep inelastic experiments. And now we need to continue and to improve over previous knowledge. And the only thing that we have left are the LHC data. So we have to learn how to exploit those. And there are many measurements which are sensitive to the PDFs. This is one example. This is the ratio of W plus over W minus cross sections, or the ratio of the W divided by the Z cross-section. These are the data. The yellow band is the statistical uncertainty, the green is the systematics, and these are the predictions from calculations at next to leading order, so theoretically very accurate, but with some dependence on the PDF description of a proton that is being used. These are different models. Now, this may look a very gross disagreement or a very gross measurement, but if you look at the scale, the difference between this point And this point, this is about 2%. So these are 1% measurements with a discrepancy at the level of 1.5 sigma, but we're talking about percent level measurements, okay? So it's really a completely new ball game relative to what we're used to in hadron collider physics. And more statistics and, you know, more refined experimental techniques will allow us to bring down even the systematic uncertainty to the level that indeed this data can be used to significantly improve the PDFs. There are other exotic things that can be done in this context of better understanding the proton structure. For example, one can use charm pair production, which is a process driven by glue-glue fusion in a configuration in which one of the gluons is very fast and the other is very slow. So we are probing the very, very low X range of PDFs, a topic that here locally several of you are much interested in. And this can be measured by the LHCb experiment, which has a forward coverage in the very forward rapidity region down to 5. And as a function of the PT of a charm, and as a function of rapidity, so within the detector acceptance, you see what is the value of X minimum, X low, which is being probed. And we are down at the level of few in 10 to the minus 6, which again, and at a Q scale, which is of the order of 10 GV squared, because that's the charm mass square. So measurements exist, and the theoretical interpretation has been given, and has allowed, or would allow you to reduce, this is the uncertainty band of the gluon density as a function of X. And the green one is what you would extract by just looking at the existing data from, say, HERA low X, while if we use this LHCb data from CHARM, the uncertainty comes down to being this gray band. So it's an incredible, an immense improvement in the range of X, 10 to the minus 5, 10 to the minus 6, once again in a perturbative regime. Q square is large here, it's not 100 MeV, right? And there is a direct impact of these in the predictions for the neutrino cross-sections. This is a neutrino on a fixed target, so it's exactly what we have when neutrinos from cosmic rays hit the atmosphere. I remind you, we are typically talking about, so this is GV, so usually the scale is given in electron volts, 10 to the 21 is the ultimate limit, so we would be interested in neutrinos up to 10 to the 19 maybe, 10 to the 20. These would be cosmogenic neutrinos, which means 10 to the 11, 10 to the 10, 10 to the 11 GeV. And as we see, there is an important uncertainty. This is a huge log scale on the production of interaction rates, and this determination would completely eliminate this uncertainty. Yes. Not only the band, but also the central value, as you see, is a bit lower. Yeah, this is X times G, so this is just flattening out, in other words, but still it goes like 1 over X, right? Yeah, yes. It's not like 1.5, but it's... So, precise theoretical description of all production mechanisms in PP collisions require not just the knowledge of the proton, but also requires very advanced calculations at next to next, etc., leading order. And of course, all of these measurements have to be tested directly on data to know to which extent we can trust them and rely on them. So the validations is important. This is an example of progress. Glue fusion into Higgs is now known to next to leading order, which is an immense achievement, reducing the systematics at the level of few percent, and a lot of those systematics are not directly related to that calculation, but are just ancillary systematics that will be improved in the next few years. And 2% is the target that is achievable once this is available. next to leading order is available for the top quark and allows to compare measurements of a spectrum of tops, like the rapidity distribution, the PT distributions, against theory. And again, at the level you see of few percent, these are the data. This is the rapidity distribution, for example, of the T-bar pair. And these are different predictions obtained by using different parameterizations of a gluon density. So there is now separating power that comes from these comparisons. And finally, there are intrinsic parameters of a standard model that we need to know better if we want to make solid predictions or, again, to detect BSM, the presence of BSM. And the LHC is contributing to this. The W mass has been measured recently by ATLAS with a precision of 19 MeV. A large part of the systematics is modeling systematics, is not experimental systematics. You see, this is the statistics is negligible. Experimental systematics is a bit larger, and will certainly go down when more statistics is available because it will improve the modeling of the detector. But the theoretical systematics, which comes again from PDFs, from the tunes of the underlying event, and from the description of the impact of the heavy flavor contribution like charm S-bar production of W, these remain as dominant systematics, which better theoretical work and better validation using the data will allow, hopefully, in the future to improve. And right now, these 19 MeV measurements compares very well with a combination of the Tevatron experiments, that is a 16 MeV uncertainty. LEP was much worse, was 33, so the combination of these is 15. And compares well with the result of the electroweak fit, so the theoretical extraction of the W mass given the top mass and the Higgs mass, which is at the level of 8 MeV. So still work needs to be done before we can match the goal of the precision coming from electroweak fits. Sine squared theta W is another important ingredient of a standard model. We are left with two precise measurements of sine squared theta W coming from LEP and an SLD using the forward-backward asymmetry of big quarks and using the leptonic asymmetry with polarized electrons. And as you see, these two measurements are quite in disagreement with each other, and the average is what is typically used. So at the Tevatron, this is the latest measurement, which is compatible with the average. And the LHC, there are already, will use the forward-backward asymmetry with forward-boosted Zs and with about 200 inverse femtobarn, which is a bit more than what we expect in the current run of the LHC. So we have to wait for the year 2020 before we get to these statistics. But then one should be able to go down to 0.0018, which is comparable to the 0.0016 of the combined average between LEP and SLD. So once again, even at the level of these very complex and precise measurements, the LHC will meet the performance of LEP. And the final ingredient in the foundations of the program is the ability of both the experiments and the theories to come up with regularly with new and ingenious either analysis approaches. Now, for example, machine learning is being used to look inside the jets and get from a picture just recognize that there was a W as opposed to a top in it. Or a new exploitation of detector and also trigger capabilities. One of the big problems with the experiments, the ability to digest all of the data that are being produced. We can only put to tape a fraction of them. And of course, there is a risk that one loses information. And this is a good example of this at work. And the topic is the search for low mass resonances. The idea is that, well, we know there is the W, there is the Z. We are typically looking at new gauge interactions at very large mass, several TeVs. But of course, there could be gauge interactions even at low mass, of course, with couplings very, very small, because otherwise we would have seen them. And we need to go after these objects. If we go after this directly at the LHC, it's very hard because it means producing a resonance with a mass of maybe 30, 40, 60, 100 GeV. When it decays to quarks, if it only decays to quarks, for instance, these quarks are very soft. There is a huge background given from gluons and it's very hard to trigger on these events because there are for each signal event there are millions and millions of background events, and one doesn't even put them to tape and record them. On the other hand, if this is possible, then this is also possible. We can imagine creating an event in which the QQ bar producing the W has a large PT recalling against the jet. We take several hundred GeV here. Automatically, we solve the problem of the trigger because these events, there are not very many, so one can trigger them and then one can go and look in detail. The background is improved because it's not glue-glue any longer, but it's gluon quark, both for the signal and for the background. And then we go and we look at the structure of the jet, or what's on this side recalling against the main jet, and we apply techniques that allow us to differentiate between, say, a gluon going to two jets and a vector boson going to a QQ bar pair. And this was used, for example, by the CMS experiment, now without going into all of the details, but the selecting events with 500 GV on one side, they go and they look at what happens on the other side. And there, lo and behold, there is a very, very nice and sharp peak coming from the Z and the W boson. If one were to look for a W and the Z boson directly in an inclusive sample, QQ bar goes to W, goes to jets, it's impossible to find it because of the background. With this technique, it immediately comes out. And then one goes and looks at the sidebands and see if there is any indication of some additional extra small structure. And one can set limits in the range of around 100 GeV at couplings which are much smaller than wherever probed. Previous limits in this range were coming from UA2, in fact, or from CDF, from the Tevatron, but the statistics were not enough to push down the couplings. While, of course, at high mass, this is the domain of the standard LHC measurement. So again, these new techniques allow us now to see signals which otherwise were considered to be absolutely invisible, impossible to put our hands on. And that is one of the main messages coming out of the LHC. It's much more versatile than we expected. So this is really the main part of the, you know, the main thrust, the search for new phenomena and everything that is needed to be able to do these searches. But there are many other measurements which I call beyond the limelight, which are nevertheless important. Of course, there is the whole flavor physics. I said something about some flavor observables, but there is much more. Generic measurement of CKM, of course, the study of rare processes, access to potential BSM violation from flavor physics, so small low Q-square physics. And there is then very, very thorough and extensive studies of QCD dynamics in very difficult non-perturbative regimes. All of the spectroscopy of tetra and pentaquarks, there are global searches ongoing using exclusive diffractive proton-proton reactions. There are some detectors that allow to do this, to look at exclusive PP, goes to global PP. Measurements, of course, of cross sections, hadron production in the very forward region, which has implications for the modeling of cosmic ray showers in the atmosphere, all of the collective phenomena first observed in AA collisions, but then also identified in PA and in PP, the famous ridge effect, determination of nuclear PDF with PA called cold nuclear matter effects, and of course all of the physics of heavy ion collisions. Now a couple of short examples of the things that are coming out. They were reported by Atlas, gamma-gamma to gamma-gamma transitions mediated by a box, of course, using heavy ions. So this is induced by the huge flux of photons from the initial state. This is a very interesting, I mean, it's QED, but still it's not something that has been seen before in this context. There are exotic things that can be done. In LHCb, one can inject helium into the beam pipe. They have a short element of a beam pipe that's isolated from the rest. They can put helium in it. It will not contaminate the vacuum of the rest. And then one has fixed target collisions between the protons of the beam against helium. And the reason why this is interesting is that this is much closer to what happens. In fact, this is one of the main unknowns in the understanding of the production of several antimatter particles in the cosmos, and it's one of the backgrounds or the systematics in the interpretation of the measurements from AMS, for instance. One of the big unknowns is the production cross-section of antiprotons. When some cosmic ray particle hits, you know, not just the atmosphere, but, you know, the interstellar medium, which is made of matter, occasionally there will be antiprotons coming out. And the exact rate, we don't know, because there are no measurements of those cross-sections. But this so-called smog system allows to do precisely that. So it will be very valuable information for AMS. And these are measurements in the region of rapidity beyond 10, so really practically at zero angle of the photon fluxes, which again are useful for cosmic ray physics. So the existence of all of this program is underscored by the fact that if we put together ATLAS, CMS, and LHCb, ATLAS and CMS have about 600 papers each published, LHCb 400, and then if you add few more hundreds from ALICE, TOTEM, LHCf, and MEDAL, we have more than 2,000 papers published. And only a small fraction of those deal with the Higgs or with the search for gluinos and supersymmetry. Everything else is material that's worth publication. It's material that gives rise to, you know, itself hundreds or thousands of the theoretical publications for the interpretation. So it's really a huge program. And which is there no matter what the LHC discovers or not in the context of VSM. I mean, we should not get stuck on this thought that the success of the LHC is measured by its discovering gluinos, okay? The LHC is, you know, existence is already justified by what it's doing with the Higgs, of course, and with every other branch of dynamics of elementary particle interactions that you can imagine. Every branch is represented by some component of the experimental program. We talk about four big experiments: ATLAS, CMS, LHCb, ALICE. But you know, the concept of experiment in this case is slightly different, right? The G minus two experiment is an experiment that measures G minus two, and that's it. Here, one of these experiments actually is hundreds of experiments, because each of those measurements is really the result of almost a separate experiment. So it's really an incredible factory of results that are deepening very much our understanding of physics. Needless to say, you know, we all hope that more is known, and the big questions that the LHC and our program in general, high energy, should address are well known. It's always the same. Now, the long-term LHC plan is to run for another at least 20 years, up to about 2036, accumulating three inverse Atoban, 3,000 inverse Centobarn, which is about 100 times more than we have today. So it's fair to say that the LHC physics program has barely started with all of this about to happen. So beyond the LHC, you may have heard that CERN has started three, 4 years ago the consideration of the so-called future circular colliders, FCC. This is pretty much a replica of a LEP LHC concept. There would be a 100-kilometer tunnel. This is the LHC, and this is the tunnel that would be required. It's about 100 kilometers. That would allow to host a 100 TV proton-proton collider, seven times the LHC energy. In less than four times the radius means that you need magnets which are twice as powerful, of course, to confine the protons. This would allow an E plus E minus collider like LEP, but at a significantly higher energy to produce Z bosons in association, sorry, Higgs bosons in association with a Z, and to go up to the TT bar, to the TT bar threshold at 350 GeV. And then one could also use a side injector in order to get proton-electron collisions. One would not use the electrons from the plus and minus collider, but it would be a side, it would be the injector to the E plus and minus collider that would be used for this electron-proton option. You may have heard that a similar project is being planned, not planned, but is being considered, at least in China. So the basic, there is a very, people often ask, you know, but what's the physics case, why do you need it, what's the, of course one can articulate these in many ways. I will try to articulate in the way I believe should be articulated. And this starts from a very simple consideration, namely that we really do have now, as high energy physics, two priorities. One is the exploration of physics of the electroweak symmetry breaking, both experimentally via all of the possible measurements of Higgs properties, electroweak interactions at very high energy, like WW scattering at very large mass, etc. And theoretically, we have to, you know, we're still puzzled by what the nature of the hierarchy problem is, what are the possible solutions. So this is one priority, obvious. And the other priority is to explore the origin of the known departures from the standard model. Again, the usual, dark matter, neutrino masses, etc. So the physics case of the SEC builds on the belief that these two directions are deeply intertwined. In other words, we don't want to focus on any of these individual elements. We really want to try to explore both because, you know, it's reasonable to assume that they are heavily intertwined, and therefore the combination of these two would bring us much more than the individual, addressing individually any single element in it. Now, of course, one of the key questions as we, you know, keep looking at LHC data is why don't we see new physics yet? Because we all expected there to be new physics around the TV scale. And there could be two ways to answer this. One is the mass scale of this new physics is well beyond the LHC reach. If all of the new particles are at 10 TeV, there is no way the LHC can have seen them. And that's the answer. The other answer could be that, no, indeed, they are around the TeV scale, but the final state are extremely elusive. It's very hard to see. The example I gave before of this, you know, 200 GeV resonance, very, very weakly coupled, which is very hard to pull out of the data. There could be, you know, very elusive decays of stop quarks, for example, with a mass very close to the top quark, which therefore get confused with the top itself. So there are many scenarios in which this could be the answer. Now, a priori, since we don't know what the answer is, a priori both of these could be right, and they're equally likely. And of course, their impact on the future of the field would be very different, because in this case you would say, well, you need to build a higher energy machine. In this case, you need to build something which is much cleaner, much more sensitive to these elusive final states. So the best way to proceed is really to protect yourself against either of these two becoming the truth. So we need precision. We need sensitivity to elusive signatures, and we need an extended energy and mass reach to be able to cope with that. Now, one remark is that when we discuss the future and we talk about, you know, the discovery, we have to accept that there is no experiment or facility either proposed or that you can conceive in the lab or in space, satellites, underground, accelerator or non-accelerator driven, there is nothing which can guarantee discoveries beyond the standard model. And that can guarantee answers to the big questions I gave before. Okay, so do not expect the people proposing the next generation of experiments to come up with a project that tells you this will be discovered absolutely. So the Higgs discovery is the last example so far in history in which something like this could be done, because we felt enough sufficient confidence in the standard model that we knew that either the Higgs would have been discovered by the LHC or other phenomena would have come up to replace the Higgs. And now we are not in that situation. Of course, people build experiments to look for G-2 deviations, to look for mu to E gamma, to look for cosmic rays. underground satellites, but none of these individual, all of them have a potential of making the discovery, but none of them offers the guarantee. Okay, so we should not use the criterion of being guaranteed a discovery in order to evaluate a project. What I believe should be done is instead to consider several criteria and use them to assign a weight to a given project. And these criteria are, for example, the guaranteed deliverables, which means what you will be able to measure no matter what. Okay, if you do a single purpose experiment to look for a specific VSM phenomenon and you don't find it, are you going to be able to make other measurements that are anyway very useful, and that those can be guaranteed? And I believe that this is a very important criterion. Of course, the exploration potential. And here to assess, you know, since we don't know what the real theory beyond the standard model is, we can only judge and judge on, give some credibility to different scenarios. So we need to target a broad and well-justified set of BSM scenarios. And we also need to be able to guarantee sensitivity to more exotic options. In other words, we can build ATLAS and CMS to discover supersymmetry, but we want to make sure that if there is indeed a 750 GV gamma-gamma resonance, it will be seen. And to do that, we want to use both the direct approach, creating these new particles, large Q-square, and indirect, namely precision probes, doing measurements that indirectly can give us evidence of new physics. And finally, it would be interesting to have a potential to provide conclusive yes or no answers to relevant and broad questions. And I will give you a couple of examples now of what I have in mind. So faced with these set of criteria, the score of a future circular collider, which would be any plus or minus machine measuring very precisely the Higgs, and then a proton collider at 100 TV, the guaranteed deliverable is, of course, the study of the Higgs and the top quark properties and the exploration of electroweak symmetry breaking phenomena with unmatchable precision and sensitivity. That is guaranteed because those machines will do it, because the number of Higgs is produced, of tops, and access to very high energy electroweak processes is guaranteed and will be there. The exploration potential is also guaranteed because we have a 100 TV collider, obviously. And the statistics will be huge also compared to the LHC. If there is something that the LHC discovers barely, and we go to 100 TV, of course, the rates will go up immensely by thousands of times. So there is a huge exploration potential. And indeed, even though one cannot come up with no-lose scenarios like the one for the Higgs, there are specific cases in which one can really formulate very sharp yes or no questions whose answers would be very relevant. For example, whether there is standard model dynamics, whether there is anything beyond standard model dynamics at a TV scale. With the full exploration that would be guaranteed of the TV scale up to, say, the scale of 10 or 20 TV by this machine, we will be able to answer this question. And whether there is a TV scale solution to the hierarchy problem, likewise, is a question that the LHC cannot answer, but this machine can answer. Dark matter. Dark matter could be axions. If dark matter is axions, there is no way that the LHC can discover them. If it's not axion, there is no way that an axion dark matter experiment can discover it. So again, dark matter is a case in which there is no way you can build an experiment promising that you will discover dark matter. The question is, can you build a dark matter experiment that at least will close once and for all a chapter in our possible models of dark matter? Now, as you know, a big chapter for dark matter is the one of the WIMP, namely a weakly interacting massive particle, particles in the range from few GeV up to the limit of the order of a couple of TeV coming from thermal production. Within this window, LHC has access only to a tiny fraction. If there is a particle consistent with being a WIMP, the LHC may be able to see it, but may not be able to see it. And one of the things that we are exploring in the studies of a 100 TV collider and of a EE collider is whether indeed one can close once and for all the WIMP either make the discovery, of course, or close once and for all the window on weakly interacting dark matter. And that would be an interesting result. So, you know, you cannot say supersymmetry doesn't exist because you don't discover it, but here you could say WIMPs don't exist in case you don't discover them. And likewise, the question of whether baryogenesis took place during the electroweak phase transition, that is a question that requires exploring the Higgs interactions, the existence of other possible scalars affecting the Higgs potential. So a series of phenomena which a 100 TV machine has the potential of addressing, either making a discovery or, again, ruling it out, which means then we forget about electroweak baryogenesis and we focus on everything else. So these are some of the parameters of the machine. I don't want to go into it. It's there mostly to document it for you. The operations of the plus and minus machine envisage, anyway, running for a couple of years, 3 years at the Higgs, but also running at the WW threshold and running for about 1 year at the Z pole, collecting thousands of times, in fact, a million times the statistics of LEP, so really bringing the precision of electroweak parameters to a level which is about, you know, 2 to 3 orders of magnitude higher than what is known today, as well as running at the TT-bar threshold. So this is a 10 to 15 year program that would anticipate, would precede proton-proton collisions at 100 TeV, in conditions of luminosity which are only about a factor of 1 to 5 higher than the LHC. One cannot push the luminosity indefinitely, but one would start from the end of the high luminosity LHC and end up with a factor of 5 higher, few in 10 to the 35. So the total luminosity would be 20 inverse atoburns in about 25 years of operations. And these are the parameters of the EP machine. A lot of work is taking place on the side of the technology, engineering, civil engineering. There are very detailed studies of the ground underlying the Geneva area and the basin, the lake. So there are already there is already a blueprint for the 100 TV tunnel. There is a very detailed design of the tunnel itself, all of the services, the access points, the interplay between the electron machine and the proton machine that in principle could live together, the injectors. All of these has really reached a level of sophistication which is quite impressive. One of the complexities of this machine in the case of a proton-proton collider is that there is a lot of synchrotron radiation induced by protons. It's about 30 watts per meter is deposited in synchrotron radiation, but if you look at how long the tunnel is, we're talking about 5 megawatts. And 5 megawatts may not seem a lot, but it's 5 megawatts at 2 Kelvin. So it's a bit like trying to, you know, put your pizza oven in the refrigerator and cook pizza while you want to maintain your eyes. It's really, in fact, bringing out 5 megawatts from 2 Kelvin to room temperature, because that's what you need to do, requires gigawatts of power. And to get down to the 100 megawatts, which is what can be afforded and what really gives is the top that the whole facility can use, is the maximum that you can pull out of the power grid, means pulling out radiation at 5 Kelvin. So that while the magnets will be operating at 2 Kelvin inside in the beam pipe, you have to be sitting at 50 Kelvin and have a very, very sophisticated design in order, this is what happens, this is the photon radiation, the Bremsstrahlung. It would just go out in a plane, of course, and it would be collected by the tip of this inner side of a chamber. And as you see, there are layers here so that it would then scatter inside instead of coming back into the beam, because the risk otherwise is that by hitting these photons, hitting the beam pipe, they would create the plus and minus pairs, but then get inside and they cause this so-called electron cloud effect and deteriorate the beam. So there is a prototype of this object that's been tested. That's just to give you a sense of, you know, the complexity of the problems and the work that's been done to address them. Of course, there is work ongoing on the magnets. The physics is being studied, of course, both EE, EH, and HH have been working very hard. There is a series of reports, five documents that have been written to document the physics at 100 TV, and there have been recent workshops for EE, and in January we had a joint workshop, and here is a slide on reference literature. So a few, in the remaining 5 minutes, few examples of physics. This is the Higgs coupling precision that can be obtained from the SCCEE, putting together runs at 240 and 240 plus 350. This is the TT-bar threshold. You learn about the Higgs even running at the TT-bar threshold, because there you get the WW scattering, WW fusion process. And you see, for most of them, we are talking about precisions below and well below the 1% level. Exceptions include mu mu, because the branching ratio is very, very small and there is not enough statistics, and TT, because well, it's only 13%, because we cannot make the TT bar Higgs process that we would require, because we don't have enough energy. And also the measurement of the Higgs self-coupling is very poor, because it's extremely indirect. So, but these are the places where the 100 TV machine can help, because at 100 TV the number of Higgs is produced is immense. It's over 10 to the 10, and there are many different channels that contribute. This is the number of events expected in 20 inverse octobarns, and this is how much more we get at 100 TV relative to what we will get by the end of a TV high luminosity LHC run. So it's a factor of 100 more in statistics. And that means that we can use these Higgs in many different ways. First of all, we can exploit the fact that since we have a lot of energy, not only we will produce a lot of them, that they will be produced with very, very large PT. This is, again, statistics of Higgs produced with PT larger than a given threshold. So above 1 TV, we will have millions of tops being produced, of Higgs being produced. And when a Higgs travels at 1 TV, it's much, much easier to detect its decays, even decays like BB bar or tau tau, which tend to be very hard to isolate. In these conditions, can be measured much more precisely with a reduction in systematics, in backgrounds, everything. So it's not just having more for the sake of having more. Having more allows the experiments to get cleaner final states and to beat on those systematics which are typical of hadron collisions and that limit the potential precision of the LHC. It really allows you to go in to do measurements that you could not do at the LHC. And the bottom line here, I have a few examples of different, I think that I would just focus on one just to give you a sense of this is the Higgs goes to gamma gamma. This is the channel in which the Higgs was discovered. At the LHC. At the LHC, Higgs to gamma gamma is a process that has a signal to background ratio of 1 to 30. For each gamma gamma event coming from the Higgs, 30 come from the background. So it's QQ bar goes to gamma gamma. Now, and this is reflected, this is the background and this is the signal. This is the number of events within a window of 4 GV from the Higgs mass. So as we go to low PT, you see that the background becomes much larger than the signal. But look at what happens when we go to high PT. When we go to high PT, the signal becomes more important than the background. Signal to background goes to 2 as soon as the PT of the Higgs goes above 500 GV. And at 500 GV, we still have enough events to get the precision at the level of a fraction of a percent, few per mil. Okay, and we are working in a region where signal to background is 2 to 1 as opposed to 1 to 30. So it's a completely different ball game. We're really doing completely different measurements than at the LHC. And the bottom line, and same for mu mu and for all of the other channels, bottom line is that we can get, for all of these measurements, which are very rare decays, which the plus-y minus machine cannot get access to, we get below the percent. The amazing thing is that one can even use this very high Higgs, PT Higgs, and look at the invisible decay of the Higgs. That's a probe of models in which, for example, the Higgs is a portal to dark matter and could decay to light dark matter particles. But there is also a standard model process, which is Higgs goes to four neutrinos. Higgs goes to ZZ star. Each of the Zs goes to neutrinos. And the branching ratios there, the branching ratio there is at the level of 10 to the minus 3. And this requires statistics, 10 to the minus 3 requires at least a million of Higgs to be detected. And again, the plus and minus cannot do it. While here the statistics is so large and the systematics can be controlled with channels like Z goes to neutrinos, etc. And one can go down to branching ratio at the level of 10 to the minus 4. So not only measuring the standard model, but also sensitive to possible new decays. So this is a table bringing overall what the PP and EE and also EH can do. And by the end of this program, everything will be known to better than 1% down to the per mil level in some cases. The Z statistics will improve immensely the electroweak precision measurements. Being able to push away the production of Drellian to very high mass will allow also the 100 TV machine to improve on some specific higher dimension operators with a reach, indirect reach on the possible on scales of new physics that can go up to the level of 100 TV. Dark matter, I already mentioned the goal. The goal is to prove that if dark matter is a WIMP, then either it's seen or dark matter is excluded. This is not something that we can guarantee today, but this is the direction in which people are working, trying to see whether indeed this kind of weak, no lose theorems can be proven. And there are indications that indeed this could be the case. As you can imagine, I mean, as I said, there is 700-page document on reporting on all of the physics opportunities of the 100 TV collider. It's hard to report them all. I just gave you some sayings of what can happen, and let me come to my conclusions. So the accelerator performance, the experimental ingenuity, and the progress in theory make the LHC today as really the most complete enriching enterprise to probe in depth physics at the TV scale. There is no question about that. On the other hand, even the LHC will not be enough to really completely explore the issue of phenomena at the TV scale. There are many things with the Higgs boson, for example. The Higgs self-coupling will only be measured to the 40-50% level. We need to go down to a few percent. The 100 TV machine promises 3-5% as accuracy, and this is what we need in order to really test the electroweak symmetry breaking process. So that means that in addition, of course, when I'm talking about the future, let's not forget that there is still the linear collider, there is Click, those are there, they've been known for a long time, I didn't go through them. They could still play an important role, but beyond that, these new pairs of an E+C- and a PP collider in the same way that we had the LEP and LHC machine is emerging in our landscape. I think that going to 100 TV, and now two important points. Now, going to 100 TV, I believe it's enough, you know, you don't even have to define the physics case. It's obvious, because in our field, we want to go to energies as high as possible. There will be information maybe coming from flavor physics, from indirect measurements that can already discover the existence of new physics at a high scale. But you want to put your hands on that new physics. And to put your hands on physics at high mass, you need to go to high energy. So it's obvious that we want to go to energies which are as high as technologically feasible. And that is what the 100 TV collider gives us. At least for what concerns the CERN site, that is the top of what we can hope, given the technology and given the geography. So it's obvious that as a long-term goal for our field, this is what we need. The more complicated question is whether that's what we need today. In other words, do we need to jump directly to 100 TV, or maybe there are better investments to be done on the shorter or medium-term future as a way to approach 100 TV. And that, of course, depends on what will happen in the next few years. Anyway, we will not be ready before 10 years or 15 years from now to even consider the decision of the next collider. And in these 10 years, many things can happen. There is flavor physics. LHCb could, for example, turn those few 3 sigma discrepancies into 5 sigma discrepancies. So all of a sudden, we would have a whole new perspective on the role of flavor physics. There is the Bell 2 experiment starting at KK in the next, starting doing physics in the next few months, which also could uncover new interesting flavor phenomena. There are dark matter searches. It's obvious that if an axion experiment discovers axions and axions turn out to be the component of dark matter, there is no point in promoting and pushing the physics case of a collider looking for dark matter when dark matter is axions. Then, of course, one would have to invest into something else. So there are many things that can happen. If the LHC were to discover a new resonance at 3 or 4 TV, of course, you know, you could say, well, if the LHC can see it, I don't need to go to 100 TV to study it in more detail. I can just incrementally increase a bit the energy of the LHC, maybe double it, and then I will have a factory of this new particle, and, you know, this will happen maybe in the next 25, 30 years, as opposed to having to wait 40 or 50 years for 100 TV. So there are many scenarios that can come up in the next few years, and all of these have to be weighted against the prospect of the FCC. But at this stage, I think that exploring its potential, documenting what it can do, and certainly studying all of the technological and the engineering challenge is worthwhile, because it's obvious that, as I say here, one day we really want to go to those energies, no matter what. Thank you. You know, unfortunately not, because that number was based on 3 inverse autoburns. Now, what you can do, you can, and that was one experiment. What you can do, you can consider that there is 2 experiments, etc., etc. You cannot go beyond 3 inverse autoburns with the LHC. That is the fact. And the reason is that the experiments wouldn't survive and would require really major, and the LHC itself wouldn't survive, because the amount of radiation accumulated by then would really require that pretty much you start from scratch. So the only thing is that if the LHC will perform much better than foreseen, instead of diluting those 3 inverse autoburns over, say, 12 years, we may try to get them in, say, 7 or 8 years. We can just accelerate that. But it's very hard to imagine that you go beyond. Because, you see, going beyond would imply really rebuilding major parts of the detectors at a huge cost. And then the question is it worth, if you want to add another, you know, because you wouldn't be, it's not like a factor of 10 that you can gain, right? We were talking about maybe an additional, say, 50%, or maybe a factor of 2 to run for another several years. There is no fixed time scale. I mean, there are events in Europe which typically are landmarks for these discussions, which is the famous strategy group, strategy review, European strategy of particle physics review. The next one will be in 2019 for the preliminary work, and 2020 for the final report signed by Council. 2020. The following one will be in typically 5 or 6 years after that. I would be very surprised if this thing were to go on the table in 2020, because it's a huge amount of money, right? I mean, it will be discussed, but there is no way, in my view, the council can say, yes, let's build it, right? By then, a conceptual design report will be finalized. That's the goal now of this study. A conceptual design report is a prelude to a technical design report. So if things go well, they will say, this is very nice, it's promising. Now you go back and you prepare a technical design report, and we will review that in 6 years from now. And at that point, about 10 years from now, there will be a more accurate estimate of the cost. The good thing is that that will come together with, you know, the physics that we will know 10 years from now. The full program of the LHC before the high luminosity phase, data from Bell 2, data from dark matter, there will be much more information, and I think that that is the right time to say, let's start digging a tunnel. Before, I myself, I'm not sure, right?
Question is probably not appropriate to be asked in a theoretical institute or to a theoretician. Still, I know that you care about this problem and probably have some answer to the question. You know, you have been speaking about half of the experiment, which is a collider. There's another half, which are the detectors. Do you expect an impact from any improvement in this part of the future?
Yeah, there is the study of detectors is starting now, because the first phase was to identify interesting physics issues, and now we have a few benchmark processes against which to, for example, the sub 1% precision I told you about the Higgs requires, you know, specific detector performance. So now we know we want to get there, and now people are studying the detectors. And one, you know, the time scale for the Hadron Collider machine is literally 40 years, right? The E plus E minus could be 30, but PP is no less than 40. So it's very hard to really know exactly what technology will be available, but there are projections already for, say, 15 years from now, 20 years from now, and those are being implemented in these designs. Some of these things have been studied also in view of a high luminosity upgrade, the upgrade of the experiments for the final phase of the LHC. There, the constraint is that you cannot do everything you want, because ATLAS is already there. You can change a few things, but you cannot radically start from scratch. So things that could be done today in ATLAS for the future, we cannot do just because of that. So here we're really implementing what the status of the art will be at least 15 years from now in the early phase of a design. Trigger technologies will be, you know, people thinking about writing out or studying every single event. You know, every single event that gets produced, studied by a software, by an trigger algorithm that's equivalent to the offline analysis and decides whether the event is interesting or not. So there are huge capabilities and huge potential. There is one big thing nowadays, I say it because, I mean, it could be interesting for everybody to know, is that we are not talking any longer. You know, initially, all of the physics was, all of the measurements were 2D, two-dimensional, you know, in the transverse plane, or what, you know, reconstructing tracks, two-dimensional. Now it's three-dimensional. These vertex detectors really point precisely, so it's really three-dimensional determination. Now we're talking about doing four-dimensional measurements, which is adding the time component. And that is crucial. In other words, measuring with picosecond precision the time at which the particle reaches the detector. And this is crucial because working at high luminosity means working in an environment in which you have hundreds or thousands here of pile-up events. So there is a huge noise. Everything is happening in the same bunch crossing. On the other hand, if we had the picosecond resolution, you could discriminate events coming from this interaction, from that interaction, and operate in an almost E plus E minus like environment when you have you know, those 10,000 tracks flying through. So there are huge things that are happening. And quite compelling, yes. Well,
yeah, I don't know. It seems only that it's perhaps interesting, but I don't see, or at least I'm not aware of many people trying to.
Indirect evidence of anomalies is always harder to get super excited about because it's less clear. When you see a resonance, obviously, you know, like 750 GeV, people get excited, they believe in it. Here, you always have to try to convince yourself that indeed the theoretical systematics is understood, etc. Some of these measurements have no, as I said, no theoretical systematics. The ratio of mu to E, B goes to K, mu plus mu minus, B goes to K, mu E plus E minus, there is no answer. But there the statistical evidence is still only a couple of sigma, right? 2.5 sigma, 2.5 sigma goes away with another, you know, throws of dice. So it's just a matter of being patient. But there are papers. I mean, there are several papers, in fact, that try to even thread all of these anomalies together. You know, like leptop quarks, for example, there are models based on leptop quarks which can explain all of the various anomalies that are seen in the flavor sector. That could be a mistake to try to connect them together because several fluctuations, maybe one of them is right, not all of them, right? So, but still, I would think that there is maybe in total about no less than 50, probably no more than 100 papers dealing with this. They may be less visible and they don't all come up in the same day, like for 750.